So, dear students, ladies and gentlemen, students here in the Heistigsaal of the Conservatorium in Maastricht, students online, welcome to the students of Antwerpen, Den Haag, and Les Etudiants de Mons, and welcome to all people who are just perchance or on rendezvous watching us. Sorry for the delay. We have some delay in this live streaming because there were some technical items. It is not as simple as we thought it might be. Everything was well prepared, but things went wrong. So I hope we are live now and welcoming you to join us. And I hear my own voice. So, yeah, perhaps. Are we okay? We are. Well, it's a premiere for me also, so I think that life is definitely easier. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the first evening in the second series of the music talks on Monday of the Conservatorium in Maastricht. These music talks are hosted by Susanna Schimak, my colleague.
Hello.
And by Abigail Richards, who tonight is not with us, but who will be there on next appointments. And the first guest in this series is quite an important guest, and we are very, very proud and honored to have her, soprano Barbara Haveman. Barbara, feel welcome, please, and thank you for coming. We have quite an impressive CV if we read Barbara's CV. So, it starts with Mimi, Manon Lescaut, Tosca, La Fanciulla del West.
Mephistophele, Meistersinger, Tannhäuser, Fjord di Ligi.
Lohengrin Valkyrie.
Ballo in Maschera.
Ariadna auf Naxos.
Falstaff, Donna Elvira.
Le Vepre Sicilienne.
Erste Dame.
Don Carlos.
Rusalka.
Jenufa.
Michaela.
Picavaya Dama, La Voix Humaine, Erudia.
A Streetcar Named Desire.
And many more. Ladies and gentlemen, all those are the roles that Barbara sang. And Barbara only sang main roles. Did you do any small role, Barbara?
Michaela, I think it was.
That's the small role. And the Erste Dame in the Paris Opera in Palais Garnier. No, in Palais Garnier, no, in Bastille it was, Bastille. I think, yes. So Barbara has an impressive amount of main roles. That must have been hours and hours and hours of study, Barbara.
Yes, of course, it's taking time to study a whole part, and most of the time, like a very role, it's taking like 2 months. I try always to have 1 month before the production starting that I know the role and that it can settle.
Yeah. Because of course, with all these roles, now there are roles like Manon Lescaut was a role you sang particularly often. You are often seen as Tosca also, Ballo in Maschera several times. So some of the roles come back, but many of the roles you sing once or twice if you have such a large repertoire. So you are not like those singers who make a career with 5 parts.
No, it's sometimes it's like a draw, and you have all these roles, and then they call you and they ask, can you sing this role? And sometimes it's only you need, for example, if I have to sing Tosca, it's a role that I sing so much. I could sing it tomorrow. It's
just in you.
It's in me, and also Simona Boccanegra, these roles. And sometimes, like Katia Kabanova, I didn't sing it. I sang it 2 years ago, even not one year and a half in Napoli. And it was like... When was it that I did it in Liège? I think it was 17 years ago or something.
Yes,
you know,
in Liège, you sang it in 2000.
And so if you have to refresh it, it becomes really like a new role after such a long time. Mm-hmm. So it's sometimes the parts are with a lot of dust, and sometimes it's with a... small part of dust, and it's just like it's away. It's okay to perform. Yeah.
So does it happen to you? I mean, I know usually that's what we do as singers. You rehearse one role, you study another one, and as you're performing a third one, or do you try to really keep the productions as much apart as you can?
Yes. Yeah, I prefer really to work on one role. Sometimes mm-hmm. it's not possible. You mm-hmm. have to start when you're also in another production already. Yeah. But it's very comfortable to just to fix and to be busy with one yeah. role. And also because sometimes it's very different. Like you, if you are singing a Wagner role and then you have to sing Puccini, it's so different from the use of the voice. Mm-hmm. So it's mm-hmm. It's not easy to mix.
Shall we get in right there and ask what is the difference in the use of the voice?
Yeah.
Between Wagner and Puccini, since
because
you brought
if you
it up.
You see the enormous amount of roles. There is a big package of Verdi roles and there is a big package of Wagner roles.
Yeah.
Can you explain us? Can you tell us what it is for you to switch between German style, German sound, German yeah. technique, whatever you want to call it, and the Italian Fach?
I must say, I want to start always with the kind of Italian technique. Like, I want to sing everything in the Italian form, in the Italian way of the floating way of singing. And also, if I sing a Wagnerian repertoire, I try to stay in this form, in the round form, and also to sometimes I desired that Elisabetta of Don Carlo would be the same as Elisabetta Tannhäuser. Yeah, mm-hmm. And I said, yes, it I can sing it the same way, with the same line. And it is not true.
Yeah.
It is not true. It is different. Also, already the pronunciation is different, of course. But the pronunciation of German is asking totally a different thing about the on the line and on the voice. But especially also the tessitura of Wagner, it's all the time very, very in the same. It's less flexible as mm-hmm. the Italian. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you have, of course, you have less high notes, mm. but then you have a different sound to make. Is that a right way to put it?
I must say it's with the German repertoire, like you're feeding all the time, you have to mm-hmm. feed. So you're all the time feeding, and that's different in the Italian repertoire. It's Italian repertoire is more flexible.
Yeah.
And that's maybe that we can say also that the Wagnerian repertoire is more demanding.
Mm-hmm. Because of this way that you have to
yes,
feed the
to
phrases
feed
the whole
and
time.
Yeah.
And there is no yeah. built-in relaxation.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But for me, it's the ideal that we sing. Like, of course, you have also like Tannhäuser and Lohengrin are almost also Italian
mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. operas. But that we sing it also in this kind of way and not with mm-hmm. a different technique,
yeah.
because it keeps the voice healthy
and fresh
to sing yeah. it in this way. Mm-hmm. I think
and shiny.
That's my opinion.
Yeah,
maybe there are other opinions, but that's for me important. Yeah.
You sang in an incredible amount of languages also. You speak French, you sing in French, you speak Italian, mm. you sing Italian, your husband is Italian, it helps. You sing in German, you are from Limburg, so German probably was never very difficult for you. But still you do, you sing in Russian, you sing in Czech, you sing in English. How do you deal with all those languages?
Yes, of course, it's very much easier if you know a language, if you speak it, if you can understand. If it becomes like a little bit Italian, it's like it's it came became like my mother language, and I'm very comfortable in speaking it. And of course, but then even there are a lot of problems for not Italian speaking singers with, for example, I'm all the time making mistakes with the doppie.
<It's> yes, who
it's
doesn't?
It's really so difficult to do it in a normal way, to sing a normal doppie. It's always, or it's too less, or it's too much. This is already a problem. Yes, then with the German, it's I like very much to sing in German because it's like such a beautiful language to sing in, but also there you have dem. It's always you make mistakes, so you're always punished, and sometimes
singer's fate, huh?
Sometimes. It's really difficult also, like in a language, Russian language, to sing. And of course, they can hear that we are that it's not my mother language.
Of course.
But if I should say I sing only in my mother language, I could not sing opera. It's
very interesting
repertoire.
Career.
Yeah, the repertoire would be small.
But do you
as a Dutch girl.
Do you find that there are languages that are closer to you than others, you know, where you, although you might not be fluently speaking them, that there's something about the melody or the taste of the language that appeals to you more and that maybe also makes the vocal production easier?
I must say I feel now very comfortable because it's like my second language, Italian. And of course I studied a second language, the French, but even the French is very difficult to sing. Yeah. The repertoire, I don't have even so much repertoire in French. And then the German, I feel very comfortable because I think it's really very close to my own language, to the Dutch.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also very poetic, it's very beautiful. And I must say I love Russian. Every time that I can take the role again of Lisa Pikova Yadama, I'm so happy, and I want to do it every time better. So every time I study to
guys, that's an interesting motive to study harder, right? Because you just love a role so much that you want to do it better and better and better, not so that the papers write, oh, she did it even better. It's just you love it so much, you want to do it better. I think that's beautiful, no?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And then the scary thing is that Barbara sings Italian in the Scala and in the Teatro San Carlo in Napoli.
Oh,
she sings German in Germany, and she sings French in Nice and Monte Carlo. So you really go to the native speakers and sing in their language, which makes it definitely.
Yes, in with the French repertoire, I did this La Voix Humaine.
Yeah, we have an extract of it for
yes, we did.
I get like the critics. It's like Jacques Brel.
Yeah, yes, of course. But perhaps we can listen to a small extract from Manon Lescaut. It's from the Vienna State Opera, and. It's the big aria, Sola Perduta, Abbandonata, from the fourth act. Yes, fourth act. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Wonderful, Barbara. Very Brava. Emotional, beautiful rendition. Barbara, when you ask all those young singers here, well, there are not so many because we're drastically reduced by the COVID, of course. What I want to do, I think that 90% of them will answer, I want to sing in La Scala, Domino Staatsoper, and Covent Garden. Now, you started your career as a small girl, young girl, in the conservatory in Maastricht. You started studying here, mm-hmm. and you made it to La Scala and the Wiener Staatsoper and Covent Garden. Did you know when you started that that was your destiny? Did you just felt it? Or did it come by chance in some kind of...
No, absolutely not. And I must say, I never had this target to come somewhere. I remember that I was during my study here at the conservatory. We made a trip to Liège, me and my friend, and we were walking around, and there was the opera house, and we were laughing, and we said, "Oh, maybe you will sing there sometime somewhere." And even that, I could not imagine at all. Not at all. And but with the time, with the experience, it's with steps and steps. So I don't believe that you need to have the desire to come somewhere to sing in a certain opera house. But you come there if you take the right steps. It's the work, it's the pleasure of the work, and I must say, I can a little bit talk about what I did after the conservatory. I did quite a good experience with competitions. Barcelona,
in Vienas,
Franco Vienas, Belvedere in Vienna, Voce Verdiane and Verviers, and this was a great step because you know a lot of afterwards you know a lot of opera directors, and then they know you. They invite you as a young singer, and that was a good chance, a very good chance. And especially I sang after these competitions in Strasbourg. Mm-hmm. Rudolf Berger, who was at the competition in Vienna, he invited me. I had it became like a little bit like a not a fest contract, but like my house.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I had a lot of contracts in Liège with Jean-Louis Crendaille at this
absolutely.
Time.
Yeah.
And he gave me the opportunity. We met each other in Verviers in the competition, and I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful that these people, they were like choosing such interesting roles, such a good repertoire. And I even didn't have to desire a certain role to sing because they offered me the right roles
in
that
you.
Time. Mm-hmm. And it came to me. And that is also the thing that makes you grow. These roles, singing these roles and going, and then I think the contracts that you get, they come in the right moment. Mm-hmm. So I could not expect, maybe if I had a fantastic agent to sing with 30 years in the Wiener Staatsoper, I had to wait to grow.
Yes.
And to become mature, to be able to sing. So everything has his moment, he has the moment, the right moment. And that's very important to just let it grow and take the time.
Do you
and
find?
I think if you go too fast, you can burn a lot mm-hmm. that you could do in between. I have an example that in the time that I did my debut of Traviata, I worked with Carlo Bergonzi, and at the same time I had a theater in Manchester was at the time who asked me to sing Tosca, and I didn't have so many experience. And it was so interesting to say yes.
Yeah, of course.
But I said no. And it was Bergonzi I discussed with him, and he said, don't do it. It's a pity because it's too early. And then maybe you can sing it, but you will burn so much of repertoire that you can do in. And I think it's not only burn, but you cannot grow in the right way. You're growing too fast, and I think that's a danger mm-hmm. Today also for a lot of young singers, that they are singing the repertoire that they maybe should sing later.
But you know, this is super interesting because we had a chance to briefly speak to Barbara before the stream, and I would like to add or to ask two more questions in that context. Number one is, you mentioned that you would like to touch upon Mozart in that context of choosing repertoire, because why?
Yes, Mozart. I sang in between. I sang Fior di Ligi. I sang La Contessa. I sang Don Elvira. Yeah. In between of the other roles that I sang, the more lyric Verdi and Puccini. And I must say, I never felt very comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm not a specific Mozart singer, it's very, how can I say, if you're used to sing Puccini, it's you're like moving all the time, it's like crescendo, decrescendo,
it's alive, it moves.
It moves.
It's flexible.
And for me, it was singing Mozart, it was like, I was putting in a corset mm-hmm. and I had to control. So it didn't, for my kind of voice mm-hmm. and education, I think also, it was not the easiest thing mm-hmm. in combination with the other repertoire that I was singing.
Right.
And I think also maybe in if you have a production, there are the specific Mozart singers, and then you get a sort of, yeah.
So you would, if I translate correctly, you would say that unlike a lot of people say everybody should sing Mozart, then we might as well say everybody should sing Wagner for the benefits of Wagner. There are different ways to choose your repertoire, which brings me to the second question.
Yeah.
How do you choose your repertoire? Because now, do you find that this opportunity to grow through the roles that you're being cast in, because somebody is casting you who understands singing and who understands the voices, do you find that still happens, or is that, because I think that's becoming less, that you have the opportunity to grow over an extended period of time and wait. Nevertheless, mm-hmm. it doesn't ring less true, right? Because the voice is the voice and we are still singing the repertoire mm-hmm. that mm-hmm. we have been singing. So how do you feel towards that? How did you especially in the beginning, you said you didn't really have to choose because it was brought to you. How do you choose now? Is there anything in particular you pay attention to? Was it the law of attraction?
I think I was very lucky, especially because in my kind of voice type, it's even more difficult if you are lirico spinto, that you can sing maybe not the right repertoire. I was happy with the knowledge of the people who ask me for these roles,
yeah.
and I think it was very important that now it's very important, maybe the most important, to say no if it's not the right thing or in the right
mm-hmm.
time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's an interesting point. To say no, but you said yes when Bergonzi tried to convince you to sing Traviata, and you were not 100% secure to be a soprano, or can you tell us about this story?
It's a wonderful story.
Yes, it's when I studied here, I think because the color of my voice is quite dark, and it was a little bit confusing. I was mezzo, but I also had very quite easy high notes. I was not developed technically. I had like two voices, and so there was it was not totally clear who I was.
Yes.
And for myself, I felt that my way was to be a soprano. And when I did this competition, Franco Vignas, it was, I don't even know if it was in the time that I studied or quite a short time afterwards. I had a presentation of a repertoire of mezzo-soprano, lyrical spinto, lyrical, all kinds of totally strange. And they said, yes, she is really a very young singer. So I get a prize for a young singer to study with Carlo Bergonzi. And I was studying with him in Siena. And yes, at a certain moment he came to me. And before, so I was considered as mezzo soprano. He came to me and he said, I want you to study Traviata. And I said, no, this is really ridiculous. It's not possible. And I was not convinced. I was thinking about this aria, the first aria. I said, no, this is not possible. So he said, please start with Addio del Passato, and I started with Ariane. And then he said, this is really okay, it's very good, and study all the parts. So I studied the part, and he was really a person who was convinced that I was...
About you being a soprano.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, mm-hmm. absolutely. And that is where I started.
And then you sang it with him, right? He was your Alfredo?
No.
Because do you guys know Carlo Bergonzi?
No. Yeah?
They do, thanks
okay,
God.
Okay, good.
Otherwise, everybody who doesn't know Carlo Bergonzi gets killed at the exit.
No, he was like preparing the young singers.
Yeah.
And it was one of the first productions that mm-hmm. I did. And of course, I didn't have a lot of technique or... But
you were young and strong. That helps also in the beginning.
Yeah.
Thanks God, people, beginning singers are strong, and strength takes part of the lacking technique as long
even
as it gets balanced with the time.
And you recover
sometimes
easily.
I ask myself if you are, for example, singing such a huge roles in the beginning, and you're really tired, or you're the day afterwards, it's really difficult to talk.
Mm. Yeah.
then I'm asking myself, is it only a question of technique, or is it also a question that your muscles have to get form, that you have to get
absolutely
used to sing such roles? So it's all a slow growing process.
Yeah. Because I think that's something that probably the three of us can tell. When you get your first role and it happens to be a big role, because when you get a small role, it's not so interesting.
Hello, Miriam.
It wasn't me.
When is the airplane leaving? So when you get a small role, it's not so interesting because you will be waiting, you will do one phrase, it will not be an interesting phrase, and you will have probably a lot of orchestra under that phrase. So it gets interesting when you get the first big role, but very often this is unpreceded by any experience, and you're not used to sing so many hours a day, to rehearse every day, and by the time you get at the premiere, you're just physically tired. I think this is what happens to most of the young singers. Yeah. And then it's the question how you get through it, of course.
But, if I may add something to this, I would like to veto here for a moment. Not because I don't think you're right, but now think about it. When you first do a small role and you do a lot of waiting, you walk in and out, you sing a phrase here, you walk out, you sing a phrase there, and you wait most of the time. So you kind of, everything, energy drops, everything drops. It can be much more tiring than being in the role and being
absolutely
in the personage, right? So it's, and not every small role needs to be boring. I just wanted to make that little remark here.
No,
and Barbara, you revisited Traviata this weekend, right? Didn't
yes.
you?
Yes, it's a fantastic experience. After so many years, I don't know, 20, 24
perhaps
years or...
No, you even didn't mention it in
smart
your repertoire.
Woman.
But it must have been, is it possible, 97 or something like that?
Yes, 97.
Yes.
I sang this Traviata. It's just in the beginning of everything. And yes, this weekend I sang it after all these years, and it was... It was a workshop that my husband Federico Santi did with a lot of, six or seven young conductors, and we were with a tenor and baritone. So my colleagues and we did this workshop, and it was fantastic. It was for the conductors an experience how to work with singers, because it is different to work alone with an orchestra or to work also with singers. You have to breathe and you have to be sensible to what the singer is doing, the soloist is doing, and of course also the chorus. And it was very, very, very interesting and very nice to have this experience, to work with them, and to be like a jukebox, to sing all the parts of Traviata and repeat again, and
But
and
then basically, if you consider Traviata the second act and the third act, it's just a regular Verdi role.
Yes, yes.
It's only the first act, and basically also only the estrano, the first aria, which sort of jumps
out.
And I think that
it's a little bit like Vepri Sicilian, but there
it's the last aria.
It's in the last part. But it's the same thing. Suddenly you get you can have quite a lyrical spinto and lyrical parts, and then you have this bravura aria.
Yes, after you had this big arrigo de pari ancora. I don't know how it is. You sang it in French, did you?
Yes.
My God.
Yes.
Is it easier? Is it more difficult? Because you did in Don Carlos, you sang both versions, the French original. Those operas were written originally for the Paris Opera. Italian opera was very fashionable in by the mid 19th century in Paris, and so they used to have a Théâtre des Italiens where everything went in French, but then they had the Grand Opéra, which wanted French, where everybody, excuse me, in the Théâtre des Italiens, everything went in Italian. And then the Grand Opéra wanted Italian operas in French. And eventually composers as Donizetti and Verdi were asked to write French operas. And so Vespri Siciliani, which is more known as an Italian opera, saw the light as a French one, and Don Carlos the same.
Yeah, yeah.
So back to you, Barbara. Elisabetta in French, no, Elisabeth en français, Elisabetta in Italian. Does it make a difference?
I must say, in this version, I like the most the French version. Mm-hmm. It's so beautiful, it's so elegant, it's so sticking to the story and to the personage. It's really very nice, the five acts, because it's also five acts.
Yes, yes. You get to understand the story.
You get the whole story. it's fantastic. I love to sing it. Of course, also in Italian, but the French.
And vocally, does it make a difference?
What I experienced with also Vespri Sicilienne, then we come again to the same, that if you sing French repertoire, you can pronounce French, but you have to think in Italian.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to almost make a mixture of Italian and French. That's, I think, the way it's making it easier. It's making it more vocally.
You cannot just try to sing it the way you would have sung Salome in Herodiade.
No, I think it's really good to make a mixture of Italian mm-hmm. and French
mm-hmm.
Between these two languages to make it work well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Perhaps this is the moment to we were speaking
yes.
about Federico Santi, your husband, because, ladies and gentlemen, Barbara is not only a wonderful singer with an incredible CV of roles sung, but she also is the wife of Federico Santi, who is our colleague here, a very appreciated colleague in the Conservatoire of Maastricht, and a highly internationally appreciated conductor who is a lot in the Mariinsky now for bel canto operas.
Yeah.
And Barbara also has two sons, so I don't know how she does all of this, but you're quite you must be a multitasking woman.
Yes, but I must say we are a very good team.
Well,
it's this is the most important, to have a good teamwork, and yes, we love to work together, but we also love to spend great time home. So, yes, I'm very happy. I'm very lucky also.
And we are happy to see that, and to see that it is possible.
It's fantastic to work together. Mm. We did Manolesco together, also in Concertgebouw.
Yes.
And we did Tosca, my first Tosca. I did with Federico. We have a sort of same musical feeling, same kind of interpretation. So that's great when we can work together. It doesn't happen so much, but we are very happy.
But I propose that we listen and we watch a fragment of you working with Federico. Unfortunately, he's not conducting, but he's playing the piano.
He's playing the piano, yes.
Oh, yes.
In Frencher than French, more français que ça. Huh? It's difficult to imagine. La Voix Humaine from Poulenc, by Poulenc. Some kind of tremendous monodrama. And I propose that we first watch it, and then you can...
Yes, maybe also to say it's important about La Voix Humaine, that it is also written for piano. For
the original, absolutely.
Yes, it's not a reduction.
No, it's not a reduction. It has been Poulenc has written it for piano and soprano. It was written for Denise Duval, and then later he orchestrated it, and we have a very beautiful extract. It's very emotional.
Oh, rien de grave, mon cher. seulement je mentais en te décrivant ma robe et en te disant que j'avais dîné chez Marthe. Je n'ai pas dîné. Je n'ai pas ma robe rose. J'ai un manteau sur ma chemise parce qu'à force d'attendre ton téléphone, à force de regarder l'appareil, de m'asseoir, de me lever, de marcher, de l'interroger, je ne me l'ai pas. Alors, j'ai mis un manteau et j'allais sortir, prendre un taxi, fermer cette fenêtre pour attendre. Eh bien, attendre, attendre, je ne sais quoi. Je n'ai rien mangé. Je ne pouvais pas. J'étais très malade.
bon, mon chéri, mon pauvre chéri, à qui j'ai fait du mal. Oui, parle, parle, dis n'importe quoi. Je serai à me rouler par terre. Il suffit que tu parles pour que je me sente bien. Que je ferme les yeux.
This was Barbara, I think, in Montpellier, or was it in Nice?
In Montpellier.
Yeah. Well, anyway, to sing this repertoire in front of a French audience must be quite a thrill.
Yes.
I can imagine. I would be scared.
Yes, and it's 50 minutes.
Yes. And how do you manage to remember it?
I don't know. It's just... the work before it's the memorizing process is it's not something that you're normally really busy with. I think it's like a natural process that you're working on a role, and with the time that you spend and working with the pianist and working in the production, that of course if you start a production you have to know everything by heart. But it's something that's working on its own. Of course sometimes you have to I work always very with things separate. I have, for example, if I have a new role, for example, Walküre, no? If I have to prepare Sieglinde, I study musically the part and I start mostly with the rhythm to know the construction and then I start with the pianist working. But then I have also my own textbook. And I take it also in my bedroom. sometimes even I repeat it only the text before I go to sleep. And it's good to separate, also to only be busy with text and to say it, to say the words and to say the interpretation without singing. Even I think it's maybe very strange what I'm going to say now. Sometimes I take parts if I have to study an opera, also operas that I sang before, and I sing them only inside. I discuss this also with my teacher that I had in New York, and she said, you have only like you're singing, but only inside. You don't have to sing always out. But you take the breath and you sing, like, but without voice. Yeah. And it's very interesting because then you can already have preparing the voice to take the placement with the text and with the music. So it's not always important to sing the whole.
Yeah, to
whole
sing
time.
Through the whole thing all the time.
Even to work the muscles in this mm-hmm. way.
Yeah.
Really physically working and to find the position and the text to speak the text to sing inside the text.
And also to find the emotion, right, through speaking the text. Once in a while,
also,
when you own
the expression
it.
And yeah. the expression yeah. of the words yeah. who are important,
right?
And this is, of course, very important if you work on an opera in a language that is not yours.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And then you have to work really with the text yeah. with somebody who is helping you
yep.
and who is saying this accent, because sometimes even if it is not like in the music, the accent, mm-hmm. it can be
the language can have it. Yeah.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So this is very important to separate mm-hmm. This work. Mm-hmm. And simplifying, I think, is always very important to get the things
absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. Never tackle two problems at a time.
Yeah, yeah.
It's already hard enough to tackle one at a time.
Yes, yep. I may be too simple.
Don't we know?
I don't think so. You know, I don't think so, Barbara. I really don't think so.
At the end, it will come all together. It will come all together.
Miriam is a noisy girl tonight. back to La Voix Humaine. It's a very specific role. What it has in common with the other roles you sing is that it's extremely emotional.
This is a person like Blanche Dubois of Streetcar Named Desire.
Yeah.
I did. Who has suffered a lot.
Mm.
So they have how you say cicatrice. They have. Scars.
Thank you.
Deep scars. Yeah. And now I think I will say something about all roles. If you are taking a role, if it's Manon Lescaut, if it's Blanche Dubois, or like La Voix Humaine, or it is a Verdi role, what I think that we have to do as singer is having a dialogue. Why a dialogue? I think if I take a role, I will never become this person. But she has to speak to me. She has to speak like you are speaking to me. Like you can express your experience, your emotions, so that I can take part of your emotions. And we have to confront our persons that we have to perform on stage in this kind of dialogue. We have to cry with them. We have to laugh with them, but we don't have to become them. Why we don't have to become this person? Because if we are really getting this kind of emotions so strong, then we are losing ourselves, and we also cannot sing. Mm-hmm. But also, I think that it's this dialogue is not only between the person that you are performing on stage, but also with the public. We are not standing on stage and performing our role, but we are dividing, we are sharing this with the public, and it's not so important who is standing on stage, but only that we are sharing this, that we are sharing this music, that we are sharing the emotions.
Mm-hmm.
So that is why it's also more practical that we don't have to be an ego. We don't have to think about, oh, Haveman is singing Tosca. No, it doesn't matter. Yeah. We have to do our work. It's only about the work and the sharing.
Ileana Kotruba said something very beautiful about this.
Yes.
She said, when we were, Suzanne and myself, young students with her in Vienna, she said at a certain moment exactly what you're expressing now, Barbara, that the singer, the personality of the singer, yeah, the person, is only the little cellophane, is that an English word?
Yeah.
Which you put in front of the spotlight. And the composer and the music is the spotlight. You turn off the light, you can put whatever color in front of it, you will not see anything. It changes the music, whether it is the cellophane Barbara, or it's the cellophane Suzanne, or it's a cellophane Axel, or a cellophane who doesn't care. It will change the music, but the light, the spotlight, is the same and is what it does it. And I thought, yeah, that this was a very, very beautiful way of saying it, exactly what you say,
yeah,
that the emotions have to be transferred and communicated.
It is also a question of vulnerability.
Yes.
Because if we have the tendency, the way of standing on stage like we are fighting, like we are a tiger, we have to convince the public, it's more difficult. Mm-hmm. If you stand and you're just sharing, but not only with the public, but also with the conductor, with the orchestra, with the colleagues, everybody, you don't have to be afraid. Everything becomes like it's not something that you have like a fight.
Yeah, yeah.
It's pure. I remember the moments that it happens that you are singing on stage and you think, what is the public thinking about me, or how do I look, or how do I sing? You're lost. You're lost. You're lost because you don't have to make yourself these questions, because in that moment I am Barbara,
yeah,
who's standing
Barbara
there
Haveman.
And it doesn't care. Mm-hmm. It's not important.
Right.
I have to do this serious work with my colleague, who is my role.
Mm. Yes.
And that's also a point where I defend always my my personage, my role in the opera. Also, sometimes you have to work with regista who have other ideas. Mm-hmm. And then you have to say something. No, you can have discussions about this.
Yes, and nowadays,
but
I suppose
we have a huge responsibility to the personage, to the composer, mm-hmm, and they are speaking through the partiture.
Yeah.
We have to be always fedele.
Yeah,
always
fedele to what is to the written word.
Yeah.
Ah.
And to the moment, right? To,
yes,
strive to always be in the moment again and again and again. And we all know you have moments that make it hard for you. But I think that's a beautiful piece of advice right there. Try to stay in the moment and stay true to yourself and your personage and the dialogue with your personage.
And of course, it's fantastic if you have a conductor where, yeah, you can connect with the regie who you can find your movements, because a movement on stage, an expression as a singer, must be totally in correspondence with the voice, with the word, with everything. It's very important. So the conditions are very important. Also, for example, colleagues where you're playing with, they can be so totally inspiring every evening. It can be different. And that is amazing. And that's why it's so full of life.
And that makes it super special, yeah. Right? If you yes. have found your personage or your connection to your personage, yeah. that also gives you the freedom to react to a new partner or to your partner doing something else the next
yeah.
evening.
Yeah.
And that keeps it exciting. It's like, you know.
I have this, especially with Mozart. We have always this different way, because you have also the recitatives and then. Then yeah, one evening it's in this way, another way.
Yeah,
yeah, it's especially Mozart is it's very fun. You can do a lot of different things. Yeah,
but you have a wonderful fragment with a colleague. It's not Mozart, but it's a colleague who is very intense, Antonienko, Alexander Antonienko, who is a Latvian tenor who is having a world career now. And you sang recently Pikavaya Dama, Dame de Pique, how is it called? Dame of Spades?
Queen of Spades.
Queen of Spades. You sang it with him. And we have, unfortunately, we don't have your aria, but we have the duet where you jump in the canal afterwards.
Yeah, yeah.
There is no jumping, though. That's a pity.
No, it's the Vienna production.
Yes.
No, yeah.
No, you must, after all the Toscas, you must be a specialist of jumping in all kinds of situations.
Yeah, it's sometimes very funny.
So let's listen to Tchaikovsky's Pikavaya Dama, the final scene with Antonienko.
Только поднял пистолет, и старая колдунья вдруг упала.
Wow.
That's what we can call a duet. It's a pity that we couldn't see here the image. Yeah. Generous singing.
Questi cantare
senza confine, come si dice without limits. And I'm sure Antonienko also is without limits.
Yeah. It's fantastic, this music. It's really.
And you do it so well. You know, even without the image, the sound is just breathtaking, and the direction you give it, and the passion and the despair.
Yes, it's one of my favorite roles.
It always came back also in your career.
Yes. And it's, in fact, it's the only Russian role.
Yeah.
That I sang.
You never did Tatiana?
No. Mm-hmm. No. I did Shostakovich.
Yeah.
The leader of Shostakovich, but also the 14th Symphony.
Ah, yeah.
So I had already a little bit of experience when I started with this role with the Russian, but I can read. It's very important, I think, if you sing
to
the
read
Russian
Cyrillic.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's a very important thing. Mm.
I do agree with that. That at least you can study by yourself and not only with onomatopoeia.
And then I worked with the first time. And the second time, after a few years again, with Larisa Gergieva on this role.
Yeah.
And every time I try to find somebody, if I'm refreshing the role, to work. And I must say I feel more and more comfortable. In the first production, I had a lot of sleepless nights with the language. But
you also start knowing the words and knowing the way it's.
But also how to find the pleasure of singing in Russian.
Yeah.
And it's more and more it feels comfortable.
Because it turns out to be a very lyrical language.
Absolutely.
Where in the beginning you think it's only consonants, it's absolutely not true.
And so I think if you start singing you're also pronouncing too much.
Absolutely.
You're not singing it to. It's almost like singing Italian, and we have to find this also in Russian.
Yeah, and when you go back to especially the older Russian school.
Yeah.
You will hear that they sing with these clear vowels and with a very, very, very clear diction, which now is coming back.
It's,
thanks God.
Mm-hmm. It's such a beautiful language.
It's a wonderful language, yes.
But I must say also in Czech, it's fantastic to sing in Czech. I like it very much.
Let's talk languages in general. We've discussed a lot about the sung language.
Yeah.
What importance does the spoken language have? Because you are working all over the world. How much English is there? How much other languages are you speaking? This might be interesting, no?
Yeah, first of all, we have to say that there is a huge difference between speaking and singing.
is there? I thought you had to sing the way you speak.
In the languages, Yes, the speaking language with colleagues. For me now, it's quite unusual to speak English. I'm not speaking a lot English, so sorry for my. but most of the time in the theaters, we are speaking Italian or German or also French. Less English. So I think. Especially for singers, it's very important to speak Italian and, of course, also German.
Young students, do you hear that? Please put it down in your notebook.
Yeah, we have to practice and we have to work singing and speaking in these languages. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Barbara, what would be your general advice for young singers? I know you're full of advices and knowledge, but what's important to you What if you could put it in one or two phrases, what do you think, what does it take, what would you say to them?
Maybe one thing I discovered from the beginning, when I was here, I saw like the instrumentalist, like a cellist or a violinist playing his instrument. And I thought, I want to play my instrument in this way. And this is not disconnecting with yourself, but it is playing your instrument. And it's also very important for the technique. For me, technique is so important for a singer to have a good vocal technique, to be able to express yourself. And this expression, it's maybe the emotions, but also to express the nature of your voice. Because this is very important. It's like honoring to your instrument, and instrumentalist is taking out the sound of his instrument, so we know have to know how to take out the sound and the most beautiful thing out of our instrument. And I think a lot of young singers, and me too, in the time that I studied, you're very. This is a very difficult thing, because the instrument, your instrument, is part of your body, of your being. But we have to disconnect this and to find a way to play our instrument. And we have to sing like an instrumentalist also has to sing and has to play his instrument in all kinds of conditions. If we are sad, we cannot say, oh God, I cannot sing because I have, or I don't feel well, or I emotionally, this is not possible. We have to sing if we are happy, if we are sad, if we have, for the woman sometimes in certain periods of the month, we have to be not, to disconnect a little bit, mm-hmm. I think.
Mm-hmm. In order to find, in order to be able to own your instrument and sort of come back to it. Right, disconnect in the sense that you are treating it as an instrument.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that is why I consider technique as very important. Mm. Knowing how to play, how to use your technique to be able to put out the best. Mm-hmm. I must say I had a very special year. It was 2003. It was the year that I met my husband, Federico. Mm-hmm. And there was another thing very special. Before I met him, I had a period that I worked with a singing coach in New York. And we worked especially on the technique. I was there for staying there for 1 month. Her name is Catherine Green. She's the wife of Alan Green, mm-hmm. agent. And I managed in this time to change my technique. It's maybe too difficult to or too much to explain what exactly, but it was such an important work that we did together, especially on the breathing, And the breathing is really like the motor, and it's very important, the projection. And it was, I was singing for a long period already, huge roles on stage. Mm-hmm. And in that time, I had to change things who are totally settled. And it was so difficult. I was recording all the time the work that we did, the changings technically, and that was very the only thing what could convince me that the things that we were doing were right. And I came at a certain moment. I had to really re-educate my body with this technical changing of muscle usement and position. That I was at a certain moment really in the dark, mm-hmm. and I couldn't go back. And I could only go forward. And it was very, very special and very, and at a certain moment it's starting to work, the muscles starting to work. I had to re-educate.
Yeah.
And this is very important, that the voice is not
static.
I want to say that the voice is not possessing you, but you are possessing
your
the voice that
yes.
you can do, and still now I am so grateful for the work what we did technically, because I couldn't. I'm totally sure that I couldn't have sang all these huge roles afterwards. That followed all these years afterwards, like La Fanciulla. The it's very, very important, the technique, and to stay healthy. And it's also, always, you have always to love your instrument. You have always to take care. This is maybe one of the most important things. And this teacher, she said also to me, maybe it's like 80% that only the nature has to come out, the nature of the voice. And we have to find the way, we have to find the ideal position, the ideal breathing, the ideal projection to get out this nature.
Yeah.
That is very important, I think. And yeah, to be critical. I do every time I with the most stupid rehearsals or stupid I mean not orchestra, I mean just rehearsals. I'm recording all the time. It's the best teacher. It's the best teacher you can have.
Your own ears.
Yeah.
And your own body to feel.
And yeah. Mm.
I think on these wise words, unfortunately.
How can you add anything to this?
Yes. Well, I'm sure Barbara would be able to add a lot. But unfortunately,
don't challenge her.
Our time is more or less finishing. So before we leave you, we'll still listen to something beautiful, of course. But before that, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to attract your attention to our next, the second music talk on Monday. So it will be on a Monday.
No.
Yes, it will. This time it will. On 18th of January at 7:30, we'll be again streaming. We hope we will have less technical items. But I'm sure we'll manage that. And we will have as a guest, we will have Joyce Uiterweidwinkel, Suzanne, can you shortly tell something about Joyce?
Joyce is a speech pathologist here at the University Hospital in Maastricht. She works very closely with Dr. Jan-Wouter Brünings, who is a specialist for, he's a phoniatric doctor, is that how you say it in English? Yeah? He's also a singer, so his passion and his competence gather, and she does a lot of work with singers, with actors, with, and she will speak about the connection between the singing and the speaking voice, the importance of the speaking voice for vocal health and for the singing voice. So I think it's you're in for another treat.
So 18th of January, 7:30. Dear Barbara, thank you so much for being with us. Thank you for sharing your knowledge, your wonderful personality, your warmth. I think everybody in the audience, and
your
I'm sure
kindness.
Also at home, could feel that how warm and kind and
generous.
And generous you are. It was a pleasure and an honor to have you. And in order to finish with something really great, we'd love to finish with Visi d'Arte, because I think that's one of your roles you did so often. So, ladies and gentlemen, please applause for Barbara Haveman.